Thanks for so much for having me down tonight. And thanks to Craig for that wonderful introduction. And it's so great to see labor history getting this new shot of new energy, new ideas, wonderful things that are happening here. Craig and I go back, as he was mentioning, 40 years. And together we've witnessed many a transformation in the writing about Canada's past. When Craig and I were at the University of Warwick in Coventry in the mid-1970s, Britain still seemed to be the epicenter of working class activism and left energy. I myself returned with the distinct impression that a radiant left-wing future of egalitarian politics and workers' control was emerging all around us. One might say I was operating in a little bit of a bubble, because in fact, Britain was on the eve of the reign of a politician named Margaret Thatcher, soon to become the organic intellectual of a vast, vicious attack on working people, culminating in the catastrophe of the miners' strike in 1984-1985. So positions once considered antediluvian and impossibly reactionary suddenly became thinkable once again, and not just in Britain. When Craig and I came back to Canada to encounter Pierre Trudeau's unilateral imposition of wage and price controls, we encountered the same kind of early neoliberal logic being imposed upon working class people. Nowadays, thanks to the pioneering work of Christo Avilés, we know now for documented fact what we long suspected then, that Trudeau's anti-labor policy was consistent with elitist tenets he had maintained for many, many years. But still, speaking only for myself, I thought his right-wing liberalism constituted a vain attempt to hold back the tides of progress, the tides of working class advance. I didn't see it as a forewarning of the neoliberal Leviathan preparing to lord it over the entire Western world. I think if Craig and I were able to revisit ourselves in mid-1970 Coventry, we would have some somber warnings to impart to each other and some insights to give to our younger selves. Speaking again just for myself, I would say this. After researching and reflecting on Canadians' experience of peace and war in the 20th century, I have come to think that it's a fundamental error to live in our silos of labor history and military history and women's history, and especially to imagine that the workers in the past had evolved freestanding cultures, insulating themselves from the prevailing ideologies and social patterns and the self-interested stratagems of the bourgeois society all around them. That workers had evolved autonomous, long-lasting frameworks of analysis and understanding was abundantly clear to us, and has become even more abundantly clear in the 40 years of articles and books that have flowed out since the 1970s. Yet all such frameworks on the part of working class people were contingent and vulnerable, partly because they were so unevenly developed in a stratified working class, and above all because of the force of the state and the influence of its official ideology, which in the 1970s was able to reimagine the political economy of the Western world. So tonight I'd just like to talk about one of the most important forces in the command of the established order, militarism. For Thatcher's smashing of the trade unions and the miners in 1984-85 was decisive on the labor front, I submit that equally decisive in the rise of Thatcherism as a coherent ideology was her victory in the South Atlantic in June 1982, when after about 74 days, she vanquished the Argentinian forces and reestablished British sovereignty over the Falklands. What was remarkable about that moment in history was how fast and how unexpectedly this blast from the old Victorian imperial past started to influence how people were talking and thinking about themselves, and even about Margaret Thatcher. Many of them were working class people, drawn up in this kind of hyped up patriotism of the moment. And thus the officious Margaret Thatcher, with her aloof snobbishness and her painfully acquired high-class accent became Maggie the Iron Lady, defender of our nation. It was chilling and striking how fast that could happen. It's not that labor historians of the 1970s were unaware of the huge impact of war on working class people, but again, speaking for myself, I suspect we underestimated just how strongly war and militarism could reshape, and reshape quite suddenly and dramatically, the fields of labor history and the terrain of class struggle. In Canada since the 1970s, the fields of labor history and military history have almost nothing in common. They've developed in their separate silos with such outstanding scholars as Ben Izzet and David Thompson as outstanding exceptions to this pattern. But overall, the Canada that's imagined by the likes of Jonathan Vance and David Berkeson and Jack Granatstein and Ian Miller and Brock Millman, their Canada, this organic unified Canada about which one can speak as a living and coherent entity, is at poles apart from the class-divided, socially complicated country that labor historians inhabit. So it's the temptation to say, well, that's their thing, we've got our thing, let's just leave things alone and let's be happy in our place, except those people have an enormous amount of power. And if nobody essentially calls out the organic mythology they're developing about Canada, it starts to attain more and more uncontested power in the public sphere. So when I embarked upon the project that contributed to the Vimy Trap that I've brought out with Jamie Swift, I thought in my naivete that there would be a whole body of Marxist scholarship I could draw upon about war and especially the class dynamics of war, especially war, the class dynamics of as war as it was fought out by the soldiers, that we would have these interesting studies of war as a kind of holistic phenomenon, not just an economic, but a social phenomenon. Of course, there's a vast and invaluable literature, much of it brought forward by Craig, on the consequences of war. For example, the wartime and post-war strikes. But to my knowledge, no one has undertaken an in-depth exploration of working class attitudes to peace and war, nor applied a sophisticated class analysis to the social dynamics of war making itself. So perhaps my talk tonight on the myth of Vimy, war and peace in Canada, might stimulate some of the labor scholars here and some of the labor activists to think about and venture into this highly difficult, but also I think promising and politically important terrain of sussing out more completely how workers and mass warfare in the 20th century have intersected. And in Canada, this scholarship, unless I'm missing a great vast literature, the scholarship is just in its very tentative moments. Throughout tonight's talk, I'll sort of throw aside a few ideas for research projects that if people are really interested in this, they might say, oh, that sounds fun. I'll spend the next 5 years of my life on that one, and I'll do what I can to help you. This week's Vimy commemoration powerfully reminds us of the ideological purposes to which a long ago great war battle can be put. As recently as 1987, Vimy Ridge commemorations in France were thinly attended by Canadians. One fellow I was just talking to yesterday said you could actually see the grass around the memorial, it was so thinly attended, and he thought maybe the French Honor Guard outnumbered the Canadians. So not that big a crowd. Compare that to what we've just been experiencing this week. Thousands of Canadians descending on the Vimy Memorial, many of them heavily subsidized by the state, school children being carried en masse to this site of Canadian nationalism. I think due in part to a very sophisticated PR machine and an open faucet of government funding, Canadians by the tens of thousands have flocked to the monument. Well, why this change over the space of such a short time? In part, I submit because a disciplined cadre of conservative intellectuals has successfully elevated this one battle into the pith and essence of Canadianism. Justin Trudeau instructed his subjects yesterday that Canada was born on Vimy Ridge and has become a mark of disloyalty to the country and disrespect for our veterans to raise critical questions about either this one brutal and militarily insignificant battle or a war that worsened rather than bettered international relations. The Vimy Trap sees this development as an ominous attempt to instill militarism at the core of Canadians' complex of myths and symbols. Nowadays, as you can see, even passengers on railway trains are inundated with Vimyist images. And Jamie tells me that on the trains now, it's not just the sign on the train, actually each passenger is given a Vimy pin, along with a leaflet that proclaims that Vimy was, quote, a milestone where Canada came of age. And this formidable foundation declares its aim of bringing, quote, our nation's tremendous First World War effort to high school students across the country. And they are succeeding. What Jamie Swift and I are criticizing is a pervasive tendency to cross the fine line between remembrance and glorification, to quote Michael Enright of the CBC. We are critical of the official circulation of triumphalist images of Vimy, such as this staged photograph of cheerful Canadian soldiers as they leave Vimy Ridge. You will encounter this photograph if you ever land as an international passenger at Pearson International Airport here in Toronto. Or you might take this example, this representation of our gallant Great War soldiers on horseback, which comes from the Citizenship Guide of 2009, which was compulsory reading for every immigrant aspiring to become a Canadian citizen. So Vimyism is now no longer an option, it's actually kind of a compulsory thing to absorb if you're aspiring to become a Canadian. We call this the Vimy trap, the trap of imagining a modern war in general, and this battle in particular, as adventures in manliness and nation building. It is a trap of assenting to an official, don't think that's me. It's the trap of assenting to an official, feel-good, uncomplicated nation-building exercise, a profoundly untruthful and childish story about the war. This is an illustration that might have been drawn from the Boy's Own Annual from the Victorian period. And in fact, if you actually look at actual pictures of horses in war, the fields of horses, dead horses, dying and dead in the fields, they worked the horses so hard in the mud of France and Flanders they could barely lift their legs out of the mud, and they would not, if they didn't die of gunfire and bombs, they would die of sheer exhaustion, worked to death. Hundreds and hundreds of thousands of horses, let alone what it did to human beings. So we think essentially this is a profoundly untruthful way of remembering the war. Vimyism tells all loyal Canadians that they should pay homage to this battle in particular and this war in general as their collective birthday. As Vimyists tell the tale, Canadians were able brilliantly to succeed in this battle and by implication the war, where other nationalities failed miserably. Stalwart sons of the soil, we summoned up our practical skills and our heroism under fire. Canadians are exceptional. Canadians are number one. As Don Cherry, perhaps the country's leading public intellectual, put it on Coach's Corner on the 5th of April, 2014, and I quote, April 9th, boy, that is when Canada became a nation, birth of a nation. The French and the British tried to take it for a whole year, and General Currie said, no Brits, no French involved, I'm a Canadian general. We will take it in 2 days. We are the best. And he moved on to salute the greatest triumphs of our soldiers in Afghanistan and the Middle East. It all flows together as one great militarist package. With apologies to the late great critic Paul Fussell, we might call Vimyism an example of the great war and anti-modern memory. Through the magic of carefully selected words and image, our state organizes our re-enchantment with this war. It allows us to imagine it as a time of wholesome, undivided national purpose, gallant leadership, and heroic achievement, our war of independence, our birth as a nation. And as any apostle of sunny ways might ask, joined recently by Margaret Wente, what could possibly be wrong with such a birthday party? Vimyism is a trap because it denies Canadians a more honest reckoning with their history. Jamie and I think that 21st century Canadians are sufficiently mature to be skeptical of a government-issued romantic rendition of the Great War, and to be drawn towards more complicated, post-patriotic, and respectful frameworks of understanding. These would attend to the global dimensions, the difficult lessons, and almost unendurable sufferings of this conflict, prelude to 8 further decades in which state-orchestrated violence extinguished, by one conservative estimate, perhaps 90 million lives worldwide. The takeaway point I want to make tonight is that rather than giving the country a unifying tale of heroism and derring do, the Great War bequeathed to Canadians a fiercely contested terrain. In the 1920s and 1930s especially, Canadians argued passionately about this war. They did not all remember it in the same way. Many, many saw it as a bitter and futile world holocaust, a word that they used quite often in the 1920s and 1930s, with Canada threatening implications, the implications that all of Canada would be destroyed in this imperial war. Alongside official icons of the Great War that we find on VIA trains and airports, and in the effusions of the Vimy Foundation, I urge we treat a similarly iconic This Vision of the War by the Group of Seven's Fred Varley, which is entitled, For What? This painting was first exhibited in 1919 and was based on his first-hand experiences on the battlefields of Europe. Working from his memory and painting this in London, but from direct experience of the front and a sketch he made of a Canadian military gravediggers at work, Varley called this his horror picture of the war. In many ways, as a subtle study in irony, drawing on well-worn conventions of the picturesque and the pastoral, Varley presents a central figure who might be mistaken for a farmer taking a break from planting his crop in a field with a homey white picket fence. Closer inspection reveals that the field is saturated with blood, the pickets are cemetery crosses, and the crop is made up of dead bodies. And I am struck in particular by the way in which the borders of the once solid things of our world, especially the bodies, have been dissolved in an unremittingly unromantic vision of this war. Using a conventional pastoral form, Varley has intuited an unconventional social meaning. Under conditions of industrial modern warfare, all our expectations of reality are overturned. Notice that even the bodies of the individual soldiers in the cart are no longer easily distinguished one from the other. Today, this painting hangs in a very dim corner of the War Museum in Ottawa. And it comes with a caption that patriotically takes issue with Varley's anguished question, for what? Well, there's no surprise that the War Museum seems ashamed of this painting and wants to argue with it. For even to ask that question, for what, is to subvert the dominant narrative of a state institution designed in large part to convert us into martial nationalists. What we are often presented with today is what I call the Big Bang theory of Canadian history. Granted, the story goes, this is the Vimy story, people suffered in the Great War, but the Big Bang at Vimy Ridge, if not the most decisive battle in the entire war, marked the birth of a nation. Since not so very long ago, the War of 1812 was also presented as the birth of the nation. One can only surmise that Canada is that rare entity under the sun, a living being rejoicing in not one, but two, or even more births. For who knows, perhaps Canada's inevitable next war in the Middle East will give birth to yet another Canada, and it becomes this strange entity, a new opportunity to be truly born again in another battle. That's the dire danger of making militarism so central to how Canadians think about their history. In grade 10 classes in Ontario today, you will spend half the year, your Canadian history course, deciphering the First World War. Much of that time will be spent constructing trenches and hearing the message, the official message, about Vimy Ridge. In essence, the Big Bang theory postulates that Canada must have had a defining war. Cleansed of all complexity, the Great War becomes the Big Bang that started Canada. And the Vimy Monument itself is transformed from what its sculptor Walter Allward intended it to be, an international sermon against war, in his own words, into an all-Canadian war memorial commemorating the bravery of Canadian soldiers. That Vimy was a mere part of the much bigger and inconclusive Battle of Arras. That Vimy left the Western Front pretty much as it had been before. That Vimy was fought under British leadership using British and French tactics. That Vimy involved unsustainable casualty levels, that is, 3,598 fatalities for a gain of a mere 7,000 yards. And finally, that Vimy led to a wrenching conscription crisis that poisoned French-English relations for generations after 1917, 1918. All these are bothersome complexities that we can now sweep under the carpet and get on with our birthday party. The contradictions of Vimyism are many, but at bottom they come down to the same contradiction, that of attempting to make official and unlikely, ethereal, almost religious, national narrative ungrounded in persuasive historical evidence. Here is tonight's central point. This version of Vimy was contested not only by people like me, not only by numerous peace activists, it was contested by enormous numbers of the returned soldiers who actually fought in this war. Many, I strongly suspect most Canadians of the 1920s and 1930s, those for whom the war was a relatively fresh memory, did not experience anything remotely like the Vimyist version of this war. The evidence is compelling that Canadians, by and large, right-wing and left-wing, men and women, francophone and anglophone, veterans and non-veterans, were moving in an markedly anti-war direction in the 1920s and 1930s. In fact, many of those who had embraced the war most fervently while the war was going on, and I'm thinking of such figures as S.D. Chowan, founder of the United Church, who filled Methodist churches during the war and made them into virtual recruiting halls for the war, basically identified entirely the Christian message with that of our army. S.D. Chowan, after the war, repented fully and said he had committed a crime against his church, a crime against his religion. But this was a very common thing to think. Ralph Connor, author of many, many boilers that were beloved in the trenches, Ralph Connor had an after-war conversion and became clearly convinced that militarism posed a dread danger to humanity. So did future Governor General John Buchan. John Buchan, you may know, turned out millions of words. He was the official historian of the war. And if you want to get the most propagandistic treatment of battles like the Somme that you'll ever see, just go to John Buchan, and they're kind of grimly amusing. John Buchan could turn an ambiguous battle into a glowing British defeat with just a few evasions and turns of metaphor. He had the most cheerful war imaginable. After the war, John Buchan is so grief-stricken by the loss of his friends, and he will say things like, "Everyone must now realize that war is an abomination and must never be repeated." Interestingly, very similar sentiments are voiced by Prime Minister Robert Borden, his sidekick Arthur Meehan, the author of Military Conscription, and even by Ontario's famously right-wing Premier George Drew. He was the scourge of all leftists in the 1940s. But he rose to the premiership in large measure by the fame he generated through his campaign for comprehensive world disarmament in the 1930s. He is the unlikeliest peacenik in the Canadian lexicon. Commemorations of the dead, which then as now idealized the departed, were often integrated into ceremonies that celebrated the supreme value and imperative of peace. This was above all the case with the now iconized Vimy Ridge Memorial when it was unveiled in 1936. And just go and take a look at how the memorial was unveiled. Here was what sculptor Allward said was his sermon against war, and the ceremony fully lived up to Allward's vision. It was a ceremony resounding to the hymn of peace, anti-war poems, and peacenik speeches. Anti-war groups liked the Vimy Monument so much they put it on the covers of their pamphlets. So, irony of ironies, that what Allward saw as a monument to peace has now turned into a war memorial hailing Canada's gung-ho soldiers. What had it meant to fight in this war? Over 500,000 returned military men and women out of a Canadian population of roughly 8 million had a huge impact on their return to Canadian society. They often brought with them unfocused rage, one that sometimes manifested itself in very dramatic moments, such as the attempt by the veterans to burn down the City Hall in Halifax in 1918. Near the end of the 1920s, many veterans worldwide wrote disillusioned accounts of the war. They included Eric Maria Remarque's All Quiet on the Western Front of 1929, the publishing sensation of the time, serialized in Canadian newspapers, and the movie was filling Toronto movie houses in the 1930s. The Canadian version of All Quiet, in my view, the more successful and aesthetically pleasing book, was Charles Yale Harrison's Generals Die in Bed. The existing consensus among Canadian military historians is that such skeptical appraisals, especially Harrison's, were rebuffed by patriotic Canadians, especially by veterans. After all, the authoritative Pierre Burton told his hundreds of thousands of readers in the 1980s that interwar Canadians en masse embraced Vimy as an emblem of their identity. But the historical evidence tells very strongly against this interpretation. And if you look beyond Harrison, warmly recommend everybody read him. It's a terrific read. If you look beyond Harrison to the 8 other war novels brought out by Canadian veterans, you will find that 5 of them were emphatically critical of all war and this war, and 3 were quite ambivalent. But not a single one of those soldiers' novels hailed Vimy or the Great War as the birth of a nation. Not one. So now I'd like to turn to the interpretation of another bit of evidence, and I wonder if you could hand these up for me. This is another body of evidence that I like because it's so down to earth and so kind of accessible. It's the kind of evidence, if you think about who was reading Remarque and Harrison, you'll say, well, that's probably just a minority of people, and you'd probably be right. Tens of thousands, but not vast numbers. But I'd like to look at something that's far more widespread, this photo series that the Star ran in 1934. A series of photo spreads about the war, many of which I circulate among you tonight. If any of you read Sunday Star, you would have gotten an abbreviated version of some of these, this treatment and some of these photos. But this one is a nice souvenir because it gives you a far fuller expose to these photos. So Harrison's and Remarque's books might have reached maybe generously tens of thousands of Canadians. This photo spread reached a readership of more than 175,000 people every day, all of them presented with a compelling, accessible, and severely disillusioned interpretation of the war, crafted by a man decorated for his role at Vimy Ridge. This man was Gregory Clark, 1892 to 1977, who here demonstrates the writing skills that prompted his fellow reporter, Ernest Hemingway, to pronounce him one of the outstanding journalists of his generation. Clark would subsequently become one of Canada's best-loved writers. His short stories about the war's consequences often empathetically recreated the experiences of those touched by it. The citation he received when receiving the Order of Canada in 1967 praised the humor which he has brought to his profession as a newspaper writer and radio commentator. People love Gregory Clark. He's got to be one of the most uncontroversial, beloved writers of mainstream Canada. His sports writing was especially beloved by Torontonians, who just really, really ate up everything that Gregory wrote. As a writer of captions in 1934, Clark does indeed reveal his sense of humor. But this humor has the cobalt hue of someone for whom the war was suffused with the bitterest of ironies. Just look at page one of the handout. "As it leaves me in the pink" is the headline of one Clark caption under a photograph of a soldier writing a letter home. "Dear ladies, do you remember these cocky letters that you used to get from your boy overseas in which he assured you it was a picnic? Well, here is a Canadian in the middle of a picnic writing a reassuring letter home. If you said it was something else than a picnic, the censors cut it out with scissors." "Magnificent gains on the Somme" on the same page is the headline of another caption. Here the caustic humor derives from the contrast between the patriotic bombast of the headline and the war-torn landscape of 1916 it supposedly describes. On page six, a shot of a mass recruiting meeting in Toronto, "Your king and country need you," asks with heavy, heavy irony, "What is missing in this picture? Why, the cenotaph, of course, because that entirely changes the appearance of the City Hall Square." As Clark also says of people in London, England, these people in Toronto, celebrating the coming of the war in 1914, can have little idea of the mass bloodbath that is awaiting them. Often the photographs were framed by titles that emphasized the horrors of war. "Roast men, boiled men, tortured men, war," proclaimed one title. "Men demonstrated that he was still a caveman," proclaimed another. "What is the net result save death and ruin?" asked a third. Clark's contributions were far subtler than those headlines, but really they worked as the same stark juxtapositions of the high ideals of the war and its patent cruelty, futility, and ruin. What Fussell memorably called the high diction of great war commemoration, in which killed soldiers are the fallen, or every death a noble sacrifice. This is conspicuous by its absence in Clark's captions. So is the Vimyism of Stephen Harper and Justin Trudeau. Clark even waxes ironic about the exalted rhetoric surrounding dead soldiers. One caption headlined "War Makes Orphans" went on to estimate a total of one orphan per glorious dead. and invited readers to imagine, quote, 10 million little boys and girls of all nations pitter-pattering along dumbly on their small, obedient feet. Try saying something that satirical about the Great War's glorious dead today in 2017 and see what happens. Perhaps the sovereign irony in Clark's remembered war was that the supposedly tyrannical German foe against whom our empire fought was made up of people more or less like us. One picture on page 4 is captioned, "The Ageless Frivolity of Man." It reveals a crowd of damaged Canadians waiting outside a dressing station in Ypres. A lone German is among them, and Clark writes, "There seems to be little hatred here, but of course, these are just common frontline soldiers. Every mile you went back of the line, the hate grew stronger, until at last, when you got right back to civilization, there you found hate in its pure, unadulterated essence. These boys called him Jerry. Back home, they called him the Hun." For years, military historians have been telling us that everybody who counted hate generals died in bed. But this line from Clark in this caption is virtually a direct borrowing from Harrison's book, and very much the same sentiment. The image that seemingly grabbed Clark most viscerally was the one he titled "Canadian and German Boys at War" on page 13. He writes, "In 1918, down the tree-lined roads out of Cambrai, came the hordes of youth of Germany to look with wonder at the youthful faces of their conquerors." This remarkable photograph is surely one of the bitterest arguments against war ever advanced. I think what struck people was the surprised and vulnerable look of the German kid as being escorted away by equally young Canadian soldiers. Even when Clark did not frame photographs in this humanistic way, readers might well do so. For example, one photograph on page 7 depicting two schoolboy Germans offering a very awkward lift to a Canadian wounded in the foot was framed as evidence of an anti-romantic vision of the war. The awkwardly carried Canadian was, quote, "hardly the subject for a painting." And this was the photograph that was used to promote tonight's event. But it hardly could have escaped anybody's attention that these very youthful Germans were assisting a wounded Canadian. And German veterans with amputated limbs relaxing by a swimming pool on page 6 are presented not as men receiving their just deserts for fighting our noble empire, but as, quote, "some of Germany's 4 million wounded, part of that international brotherhood of the officially counted 20 million men who were wounded in the Great War and who have seemed to have lost their voices as well as their limbs as far as the affairs of the world are concerned." And then here's the kicker: winners take nothing, losers take less. Winners take nothing, losers take less. You could hardly ask for a more pointed and succinct rebuttal of today's triumphant militarism. Unusually for the day, and certainly almost unspoken in 2017, is acknowledgement of the atrocities committed by our side, the triple entente of the Russian, French, and British empires. Bystanders in East Prussia, on page 10, depicts German civilians mowed down by Russian soldiers with a deadpan caption, "How shall we count these among the war dead? Doubtless the war makers count these as having died a natural death." Clark here breaks a taboo prevalent even today in Canadian treatments of the Great War, in which Canadians and their allies are generally the killed and not the killers. We are the victims of chemical warfare, for example, but not its enthusiastic perpetrators. Yet, as Jack Branestein memorably pointed out to us on the Vimy anniversary in 2007, we used it, i.e. chemical weaponry, We used chemical weaponry because it worked. There is simply no doubt that it eased the way, which I submit is a very dainty euphemism indeed for a weapon of war that leaves its victims spewing yellow liquid from their guts for 18 hours in incredible agony until finally they expire. The Canadian campaign to take Vimy in 1917, which we're called upon to celebrate, was of course the first coming out of the serious Canadian attempt to use chemical warfare. And the actual assault on Vimy Ridge was the first time gas was used by the troops in a set-piece battle. So I guess if you want to commemorate Vimy Ridge, or if you want to celebrate Vimy Ridge, as we're being counseled to today, you can celebrate, if that is the right word, the advent of the chemical warfare we now profess to find so objectionable in Syria, but which was one of our preferred weapons on the Western Front. The Star's heavy-handed editorializing allows us to be reasonably confident of what emotions it hoped to elicit from its mass audience. In essence, they wanted that audience to question and reject war in general, and this war in particular. Rather than seeing the Great War as the birth of a nation, a trope that you will notice is missing in action altogether, they consistently presented it as a catastrophe for civilization and a victory of violence. But how, you might well ask, did this humanistic critical appraisal of modern warfare play with mainstream Canadians? Here is a nice case study. Because if patriotic Vimyism has been always with us as a natural and proper and patriotic response to the Great War and its mass suffering, you would expect the Toronto Star and Gregory Clark to have been denounced on every street corner, an impulse some of my incoming emails and telephone calls tell me has far from declined among Canadians in 2017. There was some resistance. The Star's rivals and detractors early set to work to denounce this hard-hearted, suspect, disloyal treatment, and they raised the problem, a some ways realistic problem, of maybe reopening the wounds of war, hurting the feelings of those who had actually been through it. The arch-conservative Telegram published a letter from one Major Mac on its front page denouncing the Star's experiment for awakening, and I quote, unpleasant memories in the minds of those who lost relatives or whose health has been sadly affected by wartime service. The Toronto Mail and Empire, the Star's other conservative adversary in Toronto, sniffed disapprovingly that its rival was printing images nobody would ever want to place in a scrapbook. Yet many of the Star's competitors nonetheless quickly started publishing war photographs of their own. And so heavy was the demand for scrapbook-friendly photographs that the Star itself committed to publishing the images on one side of the page only, so you could put them in your scrapbooks. On February 15, 1934, the Star was pleased to announce that the Toronto School Board had decided to make these war pictures and captions available in all its schools. So successful was the series that the Star extended its lifespan. Sure, the Star wanted to sell its papers. It also wanted to arouse in Canadians an awareness of war's potential to destroy Western civilization. 89 letters were printed in response to the series. Most were signed either by individuals acting on their own account or by writers who said they were responding on behalf of entire groups. A bevy of veterans groups wrote in, giving the series their thumbs up. Entire branches of the Canadian Legion, including ones from Oshawa and Toronto, as well as the Legion's entire Zone 4, encompassing much of the territory of southwestern Ontario. As scholars worldwide have noted, after briefly heroizing the veterans, many host societies quickly lost patience with them. We like tales of gutsy, brave soldiers, it seems, but grow impatient with men and women who arrive home impoverished, hungry, or nerve-shattered, or demanding, as many of these Canadian veterans demanded, a brand new social system. And there's another great research project for somebody here. Just track all the veterans that went into the great radical movements of the 1930s. the On to Ottawa track especially is just chock-a-block with them. We need to make that connection far more closely. Some of the letter writers describe themselves as broken men. They hope that, quote, the publication of these pictures will give some idea of the horror, filth, and abuse that is the daily lot of an active service soldier. But many went beyond these appeals for sympathy to angry cries for social justice. Some veterans contrasted the true fellowship they'd experienced in Europe with the stone-cold treatment they had been accorded at home. I feel there should not be one ex-serviceman out of work, but that is far from the existing condition, wrote ex-Sergeant R.D. Morin. People have forgotten. And the war pictures. On March 3rd, 1934, the Star ran a cartoon entitled For an Instance, depicting an impoverished veteran carrying a penury banner in front of a cenotaph. The Scots caption was drawn from Robbie Burns. In plain English, it says, he asked for bread, and they gave him a stone. This is the veteran's demand for justice. How true it was, exclaimed Sergeant W.J. Freeman, 507-268 of Kitchener, Ontario. How ironic it was to build memorials and skimp on rehabilitation programs. Such memorials were a waste of time at a time when, quote, disabled men were not receiving sufficient pensions, and those who could work had to start in like myself and reestablish themselves all over again with the resultant unemployment among thousands of them. For soldier Harry Slade of Scotland, Ontario, it was striking that precisely at a time when the government was investing a vast sum of money in the Vimy Memorial in Europe, the soldiers depicted in the Star series were, quote, having a worse struggle today than ever, many with a wife and family and no work, no pension, and burned out. So, what's wrong with Vimy Ridge, this sacralized site of a 1917 battle whose centenary we are urged to celebrate this week as the birth of the nation? For one thing, these actual Great War veterans keep telling us and telling us and telling us such a myth grossly and childishly distorts the truth of the Great War. It turns a conflict they widely consider to have been a senseless bloodbath, followed by callous official disregard for their pressing needs, into a moment of feel-good Canadianism. It paints a happy, patriotic face on a strategically minor, and for those who endured the battle itself, catastrophically cruel event. It takes us back to a complacently narrow nationalism, or to use a more up-to-date language, it gives us a flattering Canadian selfie. It is a reactionary, morally indefensible, culturally immature, an empirically threadbare attempt on the part of our state and its leaders to re-enchant us with war in general and with this war in particular. Is there an alternative? Yes. Not far from Ypres, is in a German military graveyard of Wladyslaw, we find a very different memorial to this war. The grave markers lie flat, shaded by mature deciduous trees. A large rhododendron hedge forms the cemetery boundary, sculpted to grow higher between two mournful figures that kneel on low pedestals overlooking the grave of their son. Soldier Peter Kolvitz died weeks after the war began. He was 18 years old. It seems so stupid that the boys must go to war, his mother Kathy Kolvitz wrote in her diary shortly after learning of her son's death. The whole thing is so ghastly and insane. Occasionally there comes a foolish thought, how can they possibly take part in such madness? When Kolvitz visited the cemetery in 1926 to commemorate her son, she and her husband Carl decided to erect a memorial that would become known as the Grieving Parents. It is located directly across the entrance so that the kneeling figures would have the whole cemetery before them. Kolvitz's work, the mother and the father, has no trace of patriotic bombast. Unlike Alvord's sermon against war in the Vimy Memorial, its scale is modestly human. It took COVID 7 years to complete this project. The memorial begun for Peter has grown to encompass all the victims of the war, suggests her biographer. It has been the most difficult trial of Kollwitz's life. By the time the granite statues were installed in Flanders in 1932, Kollwitz had become one of Germany's leading artists. A pessimistic vision animated much of her work, shaped as it was by the defeat of revolutionary hopes in Germany. Yet it coexisted with a Christian humanism and the conviction that hope lay in resistance. By 1943, after much of her art had been destroyed by the Nazis, her Berlin home reduced to rubble by Allied bombing, and she neared her own death, she could still note in her diary the creed of an activist artist. Every war creates with it the war which will answer it. Every war is answered by a new war until everything is smashed. That is why I am so wholeheartedly for a radical end to this madness, and why my only hope is for world socialism. Pacifism is not simply a matter of calm looking on. It is hard, hard work. Is it a break with you, Peter? Kollwitz asked her dead son's spirit. If I can now see only the madness of war. Although Kollwitz's words about breaking faith distantly echo our own endlessly repeated In Flanders Fields by John McCrae, the clash between the German expressionist and Canada's poet laureate of militarism could not be sharper. McCrae implored his readers not to break faith with those who died, which in 1915 meant to continue the killing. Kollwitz, who had done nothing to prevent her son from signing up, was bereft because she believed that her generation had failed to prevent the catastrophe. After Kollwitz got the news of her son's death, she wrote, "There is in our lives a wound that will never heal, nor should it." The message on the principal plaque at the graveyard ends with these words translated, "The dead of this cemetery cry out for peace." One of the last entries in Kollwitz's diary proclaims, "One day a new ideal will arise, and there will be an end to all wars. I die convinced of this. It will need much hard work, but it will be achieved. The important thing is, until that happens, is to hold one's banner high and to struggle. For without struggle, there is no life." On a scale far larger than Kollwitz's quiet socialist meditation in stone, one finds a more official European memorial, the massive elliptical ring of remembrance, part of which appears to balance precariously out of the ground, symbolizing the fragile nature of peace. This is a much larger memorial. The ring has 500 panels of bronzed stainless steel that invite visitors to ponder a list of over 570,000 names, 570,000 names, French and German soldiers from Northern who died in Northern Europe alike. Architect Philip Prost explained that it is all about reconciliation, to unite yesterday's enemies, and he adds, "The ring of remembrance is synonymous with unity and eternity. Unity because the names form a sort of human chain, and eternity because the letters are joined without an end, in alphabetical order, without any distinction of nationality, rank, or religion." From our own Frederick Varley to Kate Kollwitz to this ring of remembrance, post-patriotic commemorations take us beyond the narrow nationalism that has so far long claimed to speak authoritatively about the meaning of state-orchestrated mass death from 1914 to 1918. Archaic, romanticized talk of valor and glory fades away, as does the strutting jingoism of those who would still speak with a glib enthusiasm of wars they did not directly experience, and the likes of which they themselves will most probably never suffer. Instead, we find realistic, compassionate memorials to the losses of war and the resolve that such dark and painful days will never again be experienced.
It's not entirely popular with Canadians, but I do believe it to be accurate of the of the events. My own early coming to grips with Vimy was through my grandfather, who was with the 15th Battalion, 48th Highlanders. An Englishman had been in Canada for about 3 years when he enlisted in 1915 in London, Ontario. Survived Vimy, was shot at close range at the next big battle, Hill 70. And he certainly felt that the effort was one of futility, felt no hatred towards the German soldier, and if anything, felt hatred, well, maybe hatred is too strong, but was not a fan of the officer corps. And he recounted a story of a lieutenant colonel coming through the trenches just before one of the battles. I don't know if it was Vimy, probably not, because there were tunnels. Encouraging the soldiers to sharpen up those bayonets, laddies, we don't want to take any prisoners. And he's just being revolted by that notion. But a couple of years ago I went to Vimy and to the memorial, and I was really struck at its lack of militarist symbols. There are none. There's no helmets, there's no rifles, there's no cannons, there's no banners, there's none of the trappings of war. There's only one sword that is being broken into plowshares. And so I do find it disturbing that it is the site of all these jingoistic, nationalist, militarist ceremonies where anyone can see for themselves that the monument itself is not about that at all, it is about the futility. I don't have a question.
just a comment, though. I mean, that's one theme I didn't mention in the talk, and there's just so much you could say in this, but prisoner killing by Canadians. Your conventional military historians will say, stuff and nonsense, all rumors. And Harrison goes on about it, and they especially think that Harrison is factually vulnerable on that point. Tim Cook of the Canadian War Museum did a very interesting article in which he basically documents that in every major Canadian battle, very often with orders from on high, Canadian soldiers killed prisoners. Not only in the heat of battle, which you could say maybe you can kind of justify, no, they killed them long after they had been taken prisoner, in many cases. And Cook argues, and he's a Canadian War Museum historian, he argues this is the truth of every single major engagement that he has studied in depth in the manuscript sources. So the prisoner killing thing, if you read the literature of a more conventional generation, they said, oh, just that Harrison must be wrong. He's just making that up. No, he wasn't. He was actually kind of understating. He was understating the case because he describes it as in one battle, it extends through every major Canadian engagement in the Great War. I found that a startling thing to come out of the Canadian War Museum. Charles Yale.
Charles Yale.
And it's you can't put it down. It's to my eye, better than Remarque, because Remarque sort of drifts off into stuff about defecation, and he wants to kind of shock his puritanical readers, and it all seems a little bit old to me. Like, I'm just not shocked, and I find it kind of boring. Whereas Harrison gets you right into, but it's all of this extremely well-chiseled, precise prose. There's just not one missing word in it. I think it's a masterpiece and deserves a world reputation. And it's still in print, which is great, right? But
I wonder, isn't there a new memorial going up? Wasn't Harper building some military monument?
Well, he did put statues on Parliament Hill itself. So the first military statues on actual Parliament Hill In our book, I actually haven't inspected them. Jamie did, and he says that they look to him like toy soldiers, and they're supposed to evoke the memory of the War of 1812. But the sculptor said, "Yes, the War of 1812," and I was drawing inspiration from, well, guess what, Vimy Ridge. You know, she said the War of 1812 has to be put up there as important as Vimy Ridge. We have Cape Breton, the giant statue that seems to have gone down the drain, at least maybe until the next conservative government, then maybe it'll come back. I mean, it was. Yeah, to the victims of communism. I think it's been stopped, although I was asking somebody about that today, and they were under the impression it was being exiled to the outskirts of Nepean or something, which. But yeah, the Cape Breton statue was going to be an amazing thing, where you had this great big huge Canada bereft, hulking figure, and you were going to be able to collect sacred soil and salt water for they had a whole kind of religious panoply of events around it, and it was astonishing.
Is it military, that Cape Breton?
It was actually a private effort, but it had lots of military people behind it and quite eminent Canadian politicians.
But the purpose was to defend Canada, right? A female figure, mother, defender figure.
Yeah, it was Mother Canada calling out to her sons from France.
That's right. Okay, so it was a war related.
Yeah, nobody would have mistaken it for being a banyo to peace.
Civil war.
Sure. I think you should go on the road on this. I think there should be short videos that can be shown in every church and in every school. I think it's very important, your contribution. But it is appropriate in the country where, of course, as you said, the War of 1812 myths, and of course in Ontario where the Loyalist myths are so strong, where the majority of people came to our country to get away from war. And that's the number, the ironic thing I wanted to bring, because again, for those of us who go to union conventions for over 20 years, and see the working class votes of our membership against anti-war positions. So that's why I listen to your commentary very carefully, because it'll come again. And what will happen is 10 of us will get up, and then one vet from the back of the hall will get up, just say I went to Afghanistan or somewhere, and the whole room will turn.
Right.
And part of it is, again, and there's a couple of pieces to this, and it's ironic to me because, again, I educate people every day. It wasn't just English, French. The labor was universally opposed to conscription in 17. And the labor movement forgets that history. But anyways, I just want to also, too, people confuse two and one. So they see the role of the Germans in one as the same as in two, and they suggest that we had to fight it. I had to speak. I was at Halifax recently. There's an excellent, art exhibit on World War I, and this very progressive artist was saying, oh no, but we had to go. He was oppositional on everything, but he brought up the thing about the Germans. The only other thing I want to add, and again, it's another thing about our immigration history, the majority of our immigration history is escaping from war. A lot of people, that's why they came to this country. And the other piece I want to add, and this is a history that I will give up, World War I is supposedly the first use of embedded journalists and the first, and this is where we get into a union conversation, the first real conversation of PTSD. So people started to understand after World War I. So in our health and safety world, I will take it back there. But I really, really want to thank you for your contribution tonight, and especially all those other references.
You've just sort of talked about it. If you're getting nasty emails and nasty phone messages, I'd like to write, just tell us, where do we write you the nice, positive things?
Yeah.
Or can you just delete them all for a week and don't read them? Because it's...
Usually I get past the first line, I've got a long day, I don't really need this. The ones that phone, I mean, I had a guy phone me from Kitchener the other day, and he started on this, what do you mean it's a method? And I was like, well, just... calm down, this is what I mean. And actually, after 20 minutes, we got to talking, and he could, I think, sort of see some of the points I was making, and, I wasn't quite as demonized, but the trick of all of this, what's going on with, the folks that in that say, you know, what about the veterans now, and they're using it in this very reactionary way, and it's that they're trying to draw this hard and fast line between peaceniks, which is the swear word, and then, you know, warriors. There's a heck of a lot of nuance that's getting missed out here, right, of people who are, especially if you're trying to describe opinion as it actually existed, people who might have been very pro-war during the war and then sort of switch over to a very skeptical position. There's a kind of, you know, the position Jamie and I are trying to argue is a kind of realist position. That is, okay, granted we're coming from a kind of moral opposition to mass death. You know, I'm not a great fan of chemical weapons, call me a softie, but you know, they just look kind of distasteful. But really the core position is more like Arthur Meehan's or Robert Borden's, which is under conditions of global industrial modernity, war is profoundly irrational and will not achieve the effects you hope it will achieve. Almost all the wars that people launch today do not achieve the effects that they hope they will achieve, like a failure rate of 90% in Ernie Ruger's recent book on this subject. He's gone through all, you know, the various wars since 1945. It's just a dumb tactic. So, you know, on the one hand, we have to sort of argue against it spiritually and culturally, but we also just have to point out to people who can't hear that one that, okay, what do you really mean by glorifying war in a thermonuclear age? I mean, the next, you know, if the atomic scientists are right and we are actually on the verge of a nuclear war, you know, we're going to have to move awfully fast to go from wartime romance to wartime disillusionment to despair. I mean, it's going to have to happen in about 2 or 3 days. It's going to have to condense the whole process of the interwar period into a very short time. I mean, that's kind of bleak humor, but it's true. I think we just, it's so irrational to regard war in any sense as a plausible tactic in an interconnected global world. And yet here we are with at least 2 hot spots in the world today that could quite easily lead to a nuclear confrontation.
Eric, congratulations for your efforts, bravo. I want to echo the sentiment, as a high school history teacher, you should be going on tour through the schools, and we know school boards may not invite you, although they should be pressured to do so. Teachers' organizations should be invited to take a look at this material, and at least through their history and social science departments, encourage your written material, not you in person, in the schools. Something I'd like to suggest. And I've also noticed over the years that Remembrance Day ceremonies are moving away from an anti-war pacifist attitude towards the celebrating the valor of the battle. And its protagonists. I think that's quite a discernible trend. You didn't mention Ginger Goodwin, one of the great labor anti-war activists of all time, anywhere, and his demise. So you might want to say a word about that. The legacy of Vimy was, we need to remember, significant or insignificant battle. It was another 18 months of slaughter and another century of imperial plunder and genocide. So that's the real legacy of this, which I think must be attached. And finally, am I right that towards the end of the war or shortly thereafter, the British, under the direction of Winston Churchill, dropped poison gas on people in Iraq and Syria, present-day Iraq and Syria, who were resisting the Sykes-Picot Treaty, the lines that were drawn in the sand, as the great powers scrambled to control the oil-rich Middle East?
Yeah, I'm not sure about the poison gas part, but there are great quotations. Sure. It's true. There are great quotations from Bomber Harris, who was, you know, our hero of the terror bombing of the German cities in the Second World War. And Bomber Harris has a great quotation in her book about, you know, if the Arabs speak out, you just bomb their villages and they don't speak out anymore. It's like, oh. And this is what's so hypocritical about how we're remembering the wars. We've blotted out the whole imperial dimension of it. This was not a war of Canada. This was a war of the British Empire. And the aftermath of the war was that the French and British Empire basically went on carving up the Middle East as best they could and just took over the German possessions in Africa. More African borders. This is a statistic I had to look up several times to make sure we weren't wrong. More African porters died in the First World War than Canadian soldiers. And that's only based on the British statistics, not on both sides of the statistics. I couldn't believe that when I read it, and then it's you know, these are reputable scholars, and David Stevenson's book, for example, The First World War in Africa, about 90,000 African porters on the British side alone, because the British were the ones that kept the statistics, the Germans couldn't be bothered. So making this a Canadian selfie is so childish and so stupid. Porters. Yeah, people, African workers. Yes, in the neighborhood of 90,000 by David Stevenson's calculations. Yes, it applied to the Entente, but not to the German side. And the Germans were actually, in some ways, just as destructive as our side in Africa. You know, that came as a revelation to me. But this is the great problem of making this all about Canada and our coming of age. I mean, the rest of the world, people who are designing these monuments, these museums in France and Flanders, think basically Australia, New Zealand, and Canada are out of their minds. And seeing this catastrophic event as some kind of happy story for their countries. They just don't get it. And I guess I don't get it either. You know, it's just preposterous. Like what the Australians do with Gallipoli is, you know, we have a little bit on that, and it's the exact parallel of what Canadians are doing at Vimy, really, and we submit many of the same political impulses at work. Right-wing impulses to deny the historical claims of Aboriginal peoples, and a whole variety of diverse Australians and Canadians. This is surely a great way to get away from Granite Stein's, you know, history of shame and go into a history that we can inculcate Canadians to be proud of. It's a profoundly reactionary move.
Rosemary and then Walt.
Thank you. It's been really interesting. Actually, I've been totally amazed that Jamie may have been on, as it happens, as you drove in, but I have not heard in a week of listening to the radio and TV or the newspapers anything critical.
Exactly.
Anything.
Well, Jamie had an article in the Star.
Yeah, okay. But,
and these guys have quoted the New York Times.
Well, I know you've been doing all this work, but you know, it's amazing how much you can still do, and it just doesn't get through.
Well, it's an avalanche of mass media. So I think, you know, we have to raise our voices where we can. This is the way I can do it. But if you think of other ways of combating this, I mean, look at the past week. I've just, you know, I got Vimy'd out about first day. I thought I would take notes. And, oh, it's just too, and it's all pervasive. It's not just the trains, but it's, you know, it's Prince Philip and the whole state effort that's been poured into this. Is very revealing. I mean, if you have a kind of Gramscian sense of hegemony, I would say this is hegemony in operation. You know, we think it's kind of one of those Gramscian abstractions that's not really part of the world. Look at it now. Why on earth are they doing this? They're trying to inculcate in all of us a new form of subjectivity, a martial nationalism that is open to manipulation.
Can I just check two little facts?
Sure.
You said, is it 7,000 meters or 7,000 yards?
Yards. Yep.
And what was the chemicals? The Canadians used chemicals at Vimy.
Yes.
What chemical?
Well, I would recommend that for exact answers you go to the book by Tim Cook, who wrote an entire book on Canadian, because the mixture of chemicals varies. Phosgene, chlorine, mustard gas, and then there are several others. The first resort to chemical warfare was by the French, who experimented with a form of gas that was sort of akin to tear gas. But when you look at the ingredients, it doesn't look like it's quite as benign as tear gas. And I can't really imagine the French just using this gas to cause people to cry. I think they probably had more deadly. So the French kind of started. Then the Germans really take it and run with it, and then the Canadians move up. So in defense of the Canadians, you can say, well, they had no choice because the Germans were doing it. That's the logic of modernity in war. That's why it's false to get all nationalistic about this. Once you get into this situation, both sides start to resemble each other more and more and more, and that's the tragic logic of it. The Germans even had one gas that was supposed to make people very depressed and confused and And the Canadians became very, very specialized at this. They would use it routinely and in a massive way in all of the engagements after Vimy. So it's a Canadian signature along with prisoner killing. Makes my heart break.
As well as carrying on in the mass media and attempts to reach the general public as I see that you've been doing. How was the battle within the Canadian Historical Association? How was the fight for terrain for winning 100 yards? How's the fight going on within the Canadian Historical Association? And supplementary to that, do the progressive historians in Canada, I know that there's a labor in Minnesota, but are there other associations of progressive historians? And are there links with high school teachers? So I'm interested in what the struggle is among historians.
I mean, Craig would know, he's the past president of the Canadian Historical Association better than I am. I'm tempted to say that once the military historians slammed the door and Jack and friends just went off and founded their own association, they now have their own networks, many of them substantially funded by armaments manufacturers and the military establishment. And they are very, very well funded. They put on Vimy conferences. There's one coming up in Calgary and another in Waterloo. Strangely, I wasn't invited to be the keynote speaker. But I was wondering, should one go anyway and just duke it out with them, or should we? You know, it would seem like a very uneven fight, right? But
it seems like they should be considered illegitimate, though, and that the CHA
maybe,
in a perfect world, might say these are illegitimate organizations.
The ones on these guys just stay away from CHA. They thought that was not really friendly terrain for them. I think they're somewhat divided too. Like he mentioned, Ian mentioned Tim Cook, who's a very prominent historian at the National War Museum, and his position is much more ambiguous. And he's part of a wave that's much more interested in the history of soldiers rather than just of war. So it's, that includes a number of younger scholars. There's another one who was at the National War Museum, Nick Clark,
who wrote a really
good piece last week in Active History.
Yeah.
People don't know about Active History. You should subscribe to it. Google it and get connected to it. It's historians, particularly younger historians, who will write daily blogs. There are about four or five times a week of the relevance of this particular research. And this guy, Nick Clark, wrote something last week. You can find it on the Active History website, which just went through the Vimy story, fact by fact, to undermine it completely. And he's there at the National War Museum. He's relatively recently hired. We interviewed him in York 2 years ago, so I know he was unemployed that recently. So I think some of the older folks are now being quietly ignored or put aside to some extent. Granted, Steen's like 80 or more, right, and is not, he's still brought out at the crucial moments, but I think there are other voices that are trying to listen to some of this. And I think Cook's new book on Vimy was a real attempt to accommodate some of what you're saying without abandoning the terrain.
He still wants the colony to nation terrain.
Yeah.
But I would say like 80% of what Cook writes actually could kind of be in our book. So he writes things like, Vimy was not the birth of a nation. It's time to give that up. And then the next page will be back to a very nationalistic sort of upbeat. It's like, how do you pull that one off, Tim? So it's well worth reading his book. I'm not trying to diss it. And Craig is perfectly right. There's very interesting factional divides, we could say, among the military historians that I think we need to encourage.
Well, it's interesting to me that Tim Cook has actually reached out to some of us to try and get some help in how to reconstruct military history.
Right.
Anyway, we've activated the law.
Yeah, I just want to say thanks as well. I was taking furious notes because I haven't had a chance to pick up the book yet. But I guess my question is also along the lines of teaching. Often I think, especially in universities, you probably only get one or two lectures in a Canadian history survey to deal with the First World War.
Yeah.
And I was wondering how you approach teaching such a huge topic that needs the nuance that you were talking about in your presentation.
Yeah, I and from a critical perspective, not a, a, standard mainstream military history perspective. Because, you know, you can certainly get into the operational histories, and I find them kind of mind-numbingly boring after a while, to tell you the truth. I've been tempted to do a whole course, maybe put it online, on the First World War from this critical perspective. I have to say, it's so ironic in my own case, because when my grandfather died, you know, he was a First World War veteran, and he left all these books. And I said, you know, and he left them to me, and I said, you know, there's one thing I'm certain of in life, I will never have any interest in the First World War. So I sold them all. And, you know, life has a way of playing these ironic tricks on you. But, you know, we have to somehow, everyone here should be giving this serious thought, and I think the point of, you know, Barry's point is that we should really be thinking about organizations of teachers. On a one-to-one basis, I'm happy to go to talk to high schools. My son's a teacher, and, you know, I'm happy to go and talk to his kids about the traps. I think a lot of the kids in his high school are off to Vimy this week. So one-to-one individual initiatives are totally invaluable, but it's not going to change the pattern unless we do it in a more organized, systematic way. And that's where we need to get into the organizations and talk to much bigger groups of people and persuade them that this militarization of the school system is, well, it's radically evil. It's not just wrong, it's actually radically, radically evil.
I just was very happy to hear you mention that book, Generals Die in Bed, which is a gem. I actually just stumbled, I was in hospital, and the candy striper came around with a little trolley, and there was this battered paperback called Generals Die in Bed. It was about the only thing there, and I read it, and it was riveting. And the important thing to know about this book, it's not academic at all. It's a sort of personal history, but it's so real. It's clumsy in some ways, the way it's written, but it's real, and it's absolutely. If you've got vague feelings of being anti-war, you read that. You're anyway, a wonderful book.
Yeah, it is, isn't it? And it just draws you in. You can't put it down.
Self-published or something. It had some vague Hamilton.
Yeah, one of the editions does have a Hamilton publisher, and it's had a couple, because I think it's now copyright has expired, so people are bringing it out in various editions. He was an interesting guy. I mean, he was part of the New York Socialist Movement. He was traveling with A.J. Mustay, who also had a kind of Trotskyist connection, and so he got involved with them, and he tried to bring out other novels after that, and people say, I haven't read them, people say they weren't nearly as good as Generals Die in Bed, which was, you know, his masterpiece, and just that shirt. And I personally find it great writing. It's just like I find Gregory Clark's great writing, because it's so tight. And, you know, he'll describe, he has this amazing scene where the soldiers are, you know, it's very humanistic. He has this scene where the soldiers are just tired of fighting, and they finally go off to a swimming hole, and they have just 1 hour of sense that they've left the war behind, and they're all kind of happy for a moment, and then all of a sudden they see the bloated body of a French soldier, and his uniform is all sort of, and his body's been bloated because it's been floating dead in the water. And you know, that just spoiled our whole afternoon. And he doesn't dwell upon it, he's not trying to pound you. It's just that image, his images will stick with you long after you put down the book. At least they did for me. They just, more than remarks. I found remarks kind of, oh, well, whatever. You know, sort of like teenage angst, it gets a bit. And I found Harrison far more compelling.
Did you bring your book?
I haven't brought, no, we did.
Between the lines, we've been trying to get them for all of these talks, and they have a very limited staff, and for them to come is to volunteer their time.
Yeah. Please get it.
You can order it from Between the Lines. It's available in bookstores and so on. Yes.
Thank you, Ian.
Hi, how are you?
I have many thoughts, but I guess the one that's most powerful for me right now, given current events, is the almost unbearable parallel I see between Vimy today making a nation, making Canada, and last week bombing Syria, making a president.
Yeah.
And I guess I guess I'm wondering if there's some, given the general criticism and revulsion of the U.S. president, if there's some opportunity to use that horrific parallel between our making a nation in Canada and through war,
yeah,
and what we see in our neighbor, except we don't like what we see in our neighbor, notionally.
But if you notice the softening of the editorial line discreetly,
yeah,
in the newspapers, where everything was scorn and revulsion and derision against Trump until about last week, and then when the bombs start to fly, suddenly we start to mind our P's and Q's, and of course Justin has said, you know, we're in, without having seen any authenticated evidence. I mean, I'm absolutely agnostic about who did it, but I would think before we send in war craft, we want to really be sure that we have some. Well, didn't Iraq teach us anything about mass destruction and allegations of weapons? I think you want to investigate this before you move in.
I think also Canadians have to stop being smug about the United States when we have our own prime minister,
yes,
totally supporting this, and all the columnists supported it too. Mm-hmm. It's been a standard thing when your popularity is down to use an international war to bring your popularity up.
Yeah.
He's not the first that did that.
And I
but
fear
it
will work.
It's time for Canadians to take on our own guy and not just go after,
yep,
Trump.
Yep.
Except for Tom Walker.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, it's obvious that it's, at some level, it's obvious to a lot of Canadians that there's a problem with that presidency.
I spoke in a union meeting today. The majority of Syrians who have come to our country are against what Trump did.
Yeah.
Interesting.
And if there's one source, and they came from all different sides within Syria, and they've all been here because of the war, and they all condemn what Trump did. And so I use that as the facts to talk to Canadians about.
We're into an era, of course, where facts are not really
important. Just to say, those are the facts. Syrians are opposed.
Yeah, the Toronto Star's response to our book was saying, you know, they've got lots of evidence and theories and research, lots of research. And but nonetheless, that just goes to show how important and strong Vimy is. It's like,
yes.
But I think evidence-based research, you know, gather the evidence and really, and I think maybe if this keeps up in the Middle East, I mean, we're going to have to build a massive anti-war movement. You know, it's just like the last movement that comes to mind would be the war in Vietnam. And
if the effort to keep us out of Iraq.
Yeah. Yes, it was huge. He's been waving his hand. I didn't
realize you actually wanted to ask a question.
The War of 1812 business didn't go over very well.
No.
The Harper government was not able to garner a lot of enthusiasm for it. And for his militarism, generally speaking, do you think that this is different somehow with Trudeau? And do you think it's captured the consciousness of the population? Or is it just one of those things that dribbles by and will be gone tomorrow?
I earnestly hope, of course, that the second is true. I don't think it is. I think once you've done this and made this like the great national holiday, the birth of the nation, I don't think you think can dial that down very readily, say, oh, well, you know, we've got many other things on our plate and we don't really want. I think this annual event will keep on happening and all of its attended messages will keep on being reinforced. That's my fear. And
well, it isn't like the 100-year anniversary of Canada where there was a lot of hoo-ha.
Yeah.
It's not, it's the 150, and the 150 is not going over very well either.
I wouldn't have thought so. It seems to be dead in the water as far as I can see. And you're right, the War of 1812, they really pumped a lot of money into that. The most unlikely connections were being made with the War of 1812 and whatever historic site. And if you were in a local historical society, you were sort of struggling to find some, you know, some connection, and then you would get thousands of dollars. And it was really a grim revelation of how public history is conducted in the country. We'll have to wait and see. I think it's early days yet with Trudeau. He's sending off these signals, and as often, even before he became prime minister, sent off these signals of, you know, the reason why Canada punches above its weight, the quotation we use in the book, the reason why Canada punches above its weight and is respected in the world is we proved ourselves in the trenches of France and Flanders, and we, showed up in the Second World War. And, you know, this kind of, it seems to be very deep-seated part of his understanding of the country. So as long as that's the case, I don't see a significant change.
Well, he is a school teacher, right? He's been teaching that.
Okay, folks. I think we've kept the end on for 2 hours.